Hey everyone, I am Matt Topol, Principal Software Architect at FactSet Research Systems, and I'm going to talk about using GraphQL with Apache Arrow rather than the traditional JSON. So when coming at this from the usual perspective of why you want to use GraphQL in general, to use Apache Arrow instead of JSON, you have to have a good reason because you have all this tooling that already exists. And for us, it was performance, which is important for everyone. So why use GraphQL in the first place? Well, that's what this use case little thing here is for, is to explain why we're using GraphQL in the beginning. We've got data sets that are consistently adding new data points and new properties, but are also interconnected and interleaved. The data lives in different data stores. They can be in SQL Server, Postgres, Parquet files, and S3. It could be whatever. But there's no standardized schema across all of them. You have to kind of work it out. So by creating a dynamically generated GraphQL schema that's deterministically generated, it makes it really easy for all the different internal consumers with all their different query patterns to use the GraphQL interface without sacrificing the performance, because we're going to use Arrow to get the transform bonus and the data transfer benefits. Things to consider when you're doing this: the use of GraphQL allows us to abstract the querying from the data sources and the complexity of meshing all that data. We can ensure data consistency on the service side and do cross data set queries where you're querying from one data set that's related to others in a single query, but making it much easier to write. And then, of course, once again, performance and data transfer benefits by using Arrow. I'm not going to go into the actual structure of Arrow because, well, that's literally what most of this conference is about. So I'm sure there's other people who have done it much better than me. So I'm going to focus on the usage of GraphQL with Arrow. In our usage, when we were doing it for our service, we had Dremio as a query engine. We had a GraphQL service on top of that. And everything was translated in Apache Arrow and transferred and communicated that way. And the main benefit there is because Dremio has an Arrow Flight interface. So we provide an Arrow Flight interface to our GraphQL service. Arrow Flight has a do-get where you can, and for us, what we did was you stick your GraphQL query as a serialized protobuf in the GraphQL. Sorry, in the, you stick your GraphQL string as a serialized protobuf. Pass that to the GraphQL service. It generates one or more SQL queries as necessary, and then creates a pipeline and streams all of the Arrow record batches out as we get them, as we need them, which gives you an extremely small memory footprint on the service because everything is just streaming all the way through. You can stream gigabytes of data, but only requiring a couple less than 100 megabytes on the service at a time. Additionally, the service is written in Go. We're throwing Arrow Flight RPC across gRPC, Dremio is deployed using Kubernetes, and here you can see the links to the main libraries we were using. We have the GraphQL Go tools library, provides a very easy setup for converting the GraphQL query into a plan. So we write a planner to generate the queries. And then, of course, the Go Apache Arrow library. And then just to kind of get the idea across, you can see what an example of one of these schemas is right here. As I said, remember, dynamically generating the schema using metadata. So there is a YAML metadata file that is owned by the content owners. And those content owners can fill in the different attributes and data points that exist. New data point, well, they just add an entry to the YAML metadata. It pops, so it flows through. And then the service updates the GraphQL schema and everything just flows through seamlessly. automatically updating and generating the schema as we go. If you look at the way it's generated here, we've got these arguments that are actually very similar to what you might see with a SQL query. Almost, you have a limit, an offset. If you want to paginate and you only get a small chunk of the results, you got a where argument for filtering, and you can see that that expands out. The metadata also allows the content owners to define relationships between the data. Because we're dynamically generating this, the GraphQL schema, the metadata relationships allow us to do things like you see in that where clause, where you can actually filter these deal transactions by the underlying, say, banks or the transaction buyers of the transaction or other interactions between the different types and the different entities that are involved. Now, when you want to be able to test it, you're going to still want to probably have a JSON output, just so you can have a UI to make it easy for testing. Over here, you can see on the right side that since we were using Go, it is extremely easy to take that Arrow record batch and generate JSON from it. Because, as I mentioned, since Arrow supports all those nested complexities and complex data types, it can map really, really easily to a JSON structure, which makes it simple to write a handler to convert it on the fly if necessary, but allow anyone who is able to use Arrow Flight directly to benefit from not having to pay the cost of that translation. Of course, there's also benefits to that schema generation I was talking about. As I mentioned, because everything's driven by this metadata, it creates a much faster time to market for adding new content. And we're able to build much more automation and validation into the metadata and into the processing to make life easier for our product owners and content owners. You don't want your consumers writing SQL, because it is very, very easy to write extremely inefficient SQL. That was the other reason for using GraphQL in the first place, is because it provides that very easy to write interface for our consumers, abstracting the actual data sources away so that we can handle all the interactions and relationships and communications. So you end up with significantly reduced maintenance efforts, and you can easily create a templated query that is extremely fast and deterministically generate it based on the GraphQL queries, regardless of what the query patterns we get are, because the GraphQL enforces a consistent query pattern. Looking forward, we want to be adding more self-service tooling for adding more metadata. Right now it's just plain YAML files, but because we've identified and set everything up using these metadata and these YAML files, it's very easy to write this automation because everything flows through and just generates GraphQL. And because of the way GraphQL works, we can improve that higher level query planning and add levels of caching in, and maybe even send that data to be fetched from other data stores other than Dremio if we need super low latency queries. Again, the usage here is that Arrow is super fast to give us the benefits of not having to pay for serialization and deserialization over using JSON. Now, if you're still learning about Arrow, still trying to figure out how it works or how to use it, Arrow Flight, I'm gonna shamelessly plug my book. I recently wrote the first book that I'm aware of on Apache Arrow, and it goes live on sale on Amazon on June 24th. So if you're still learning how to use Arrow or just want to learn how to integrate with the different things or just get better at it, I highly recommend, please give it a try, take a look, see what you like. Thank you very much. I hope you enjoyed my quick little lightning talk. Take care.